God's house tonight.
Amen.
Praise God. Well, I've been looking at different sections of the book of John. Although I could review, I'm not going to review. Sometimes I feel like that's it's good for us, it's good to petition, but I don't feel like I'm there tonight. Amen. Good for us to be back tonight. Appreciate everybody carrying on last Tuesday night. We are glad to be a week past the flu bug hitting our, not the flu bug, but the GI bug hitting our family. Amen. So we don't wish that on anybody. And so we're just glad to be back Tuesday night as well. Amen. So we missed you all last Tuesday night. But thank you for being here. Let's turn tonight to the book of John, chapter number 3. And I'm going to deal with probably the most familiar verse in the whole Bible a little bit later. I've preached on it before. I enjoy it. Don't mean to be redundant in any way. But I believe that we can bring new light to this tonight. Because I think sometimes we don't really often think about what's happening here before verse number 16. Jesus, the Bible says that there was a man of the Pharisees whose name was Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. The same came to Jesus by night and said unto him, Rabbi, we know that thou art a teacher come from God, and that we represented Nicodemus, but it also represented the group of Sanhedrin in which he belonged to. And he said, you know, we know that you're a teacher, you're come from God. But the problem with Nicodemus was that he never got by the staggering problem that a lot of the Jewish people had. They couldn't get by the fact that he was a man, but yet he was God. And so he recognizes Jesus as being this man, a good man, a good teacher that's come from God. And we do see later, I told you, that Nicodemus, we find him with the body and the burial of Jesus and spices. So we tend to believe that somewhere, you know, with the effect of the cross, that it changed a man's life. How many has been changed by a cross? Amen. Amen. And so, that's the hopeful part, amen, that we see of Nicodemus, a cross changing everything. And he said, for Jesus, no man can do these miracles except God is with him. Amen. That is correct. Amen. The only miracles I want to see is the working of God. Now, there can be a lot of hocus pocus and a lot of things that is outside the realm of godliness and righteousness. But I want God in the middle of it. Amen. The Bible says, Jesus answered and said, Mary, I say to you, except the man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Amen. Nicodemus, you've already had a physical birth, but it's necessary that you have a spiritual birth. The only way to see the kingdom of God, the only way to make it to heaven, is to be born again. You know, that terminology and that phrase, I want to encourage us as believers not to shy away from it, because it is really the standard in which Jesus gave us. Amen. Folks may say, well, that seems like a little bit of crazy, wild out there. Well, it seemed the same way with Jesus. You know, Nicodemus says, how can a man be born again? How can a man enter back into his mother's womb when he is old? How can he be born that second time? Amen. And Jesus said, lest a man be born of water and of the Spirit. Amen. The water, that natural, but the Spirit is a spiritual birth. Amen. You got to be born naturally, obviously, but you got to be born of the Spirit. It's the only way to see the kingdom of God. So when we talk to someone about salvation, the necessary thing is you got to be born again.
Now we're going to talk a little bit about believing a little bit later when we get down in here. It's necessary to believe. That's the basis of being born again. The believing will cause an action that will cause us to repent of our sins. And the repenting of our sins brings a new birth to regeneration. And so salvation is that. And you got to have faith. It's a birth that comes only through the Spirit. And unless you're born of the Spirit, you will not see the kingdom of God. Jesus said, that which is born of flesh is the flesh. But that which is born of the Spirit is the Spirit. So of the flesh alone, there is no relationship with God. But when we are born of the Spirit, it creates a relationship with God. Unless one has a relationship with God, they would die and go to hell. Dealing with death, probably on a higher level, and talking to folks, you know, I'll talk to folks and they'll say, well, I know they believed. It has to go farther than believing. Because devils believe. But they don't have conversion. So it's that conversion that comes through the regeneration of being born again through the Spirit of God. It's the Spirit of God that makes the atoning work of the cross have validity in our life. Thank God for the Spirit. Jesus said, I must go away. The work of the cross, Jesus could have stayed. But if he didn't go away, then the working of the Spirit of God to make the work of the cross real in the lives of whosoever will would have never happened. And so he went away to prepare a place for us. But he sent that Comforter. The Comforter was with the believer, but the Comforter was also what would draw men to God, the Spirit of God. Jesus said, marvel not that I say unto you, you must be born again. You've got to be born again. So, if you think, why did Jesus love Nicodemus? They're having this conversation at night. Maybe the candlelight is there, it's lit. And so he's looking at Nicodemus, and he says to Nicodemus, you can't just be born of the flesh, you also must be born of the Spirit. And so this look must have come on Nicodemus' face. And Jesus said to Nicodemus, don't marvel. The look on your face, you must be born again. Thank you for being my teacher.
You were the closest.
You're the closest.
That's right. Don't move back because of that. Keep on coming in.
So it was that look on his face, you know, don't marvel. You must be born again. Jumping down to verse number 9, Nicodemus, and I know that we've looked at some of the stuff, but it really gives me an introduction to where we're going tonight. Nicodemus answered and said unto him, how can these things be? How can born again be? You know, this is an intelligent man, Sister Jane. He's not dumb. He's a learned man. He's a wealthy man. Probably the third wealthiest man of his throne, from everything that we have and given to us. But the truth is, he sees Jesus as being earthly, but he's not got the glimpse of him being heavenly. No, we've got to get a glimpse of Jesus as being God. You know, a lot of folks see him, a picture of him, his face, or knocking on the door, or whatever religious relic they may put a lot of confidence and hope and trust in. But until you move past all those things and see him as God, and even see him as God, you won't know salvation. Jesus said to him, are you not the master of Israel? And knowest not these things. You know, you're spiritual. You're a spiritual leader, and you don't know the way to heaven. I'm telling you the way to heaven. How many spiritual leaders don't know the way to heaven? You know, it becomes a tradition. It becomes a profession or a career without ever really knowing how to give the knowledge of the gift of life through the Word of God. And He says, "Verily, verily, I say unto you, we speak that we don't know." You teach, but you really don't know, Nicodemus. And you testify of that which we have seen, and you receive not our witness. Then I really like verse number 12. If I had told you earthly things, and you believe not. You see, Jesus was saying, Nicodemus, you know everything about the sacrifices. You know everything about traditions, feasts. But you're missing the shadow of what it is. You know, you don't understand. You're not getting there. So how can you understand the heavenly things? Then he says, how shall you believe if I tell you of heavenly things? Nicodemus addressed Jesus as a mere teacher. He has to believe in him as being God. You have to know me as God to understand these heavenly things. We got to get off the earthly things. We got to get the heavenly things. Sometimes it's a hardship for the Justin to get people to make a move from what they see in right here to eternal things. And he said, no man hath ascended up to heaven, but he who came down from heaven, even the Son of Man, which is in heaven. Better translated, I don't want people to be confused, which is from heaven. No one's going to heaven. You never been there. But God sent his Son down to earth to you. That's why I'm here. To tell you about the way of salvation. Talk about the love of God. Talk about the plan of God. Talk about the direction of God, the compassion of God, that he would come to earth to show us. And the Word of God says, as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness. Now let's look at this. I like what one commentator said. It's really good. Now, I know that we think about the brazen serpent and thinking about the fiery serpents. But let's go way back to the beginning. What does the serpent represent? Evil, the devil. So if Moses lifted the serpent up in the wilderness, even so the Son of Man must be lifted up. Jesus needs to be lifted up because he's the only one who can combat the enemy and destroy him. Amen. And so tonight, he must be lifted up. He can't be left as a mere man, as a prophet. That's the problem with a lot of religions. They leave him a man. They leave him a prophet. And then there's no combat. There's no overcoming of Satan and evil. He must be seen as the God-man. Amen. Who died on the cross. God who died on the cross. Amen. To overcome evil, to overcome sin, to overcome the curse of sin. Amen. The guilt of sin. Amen. And to free from sin. The nature of sin. Amen. So he said, even so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Amen. The only way to have immortality, that means that you never die, is to believe and trust and have a relationship, not with Jesus as man, but as Jesus as God. So, believing on him. And so all this, I don't know, I just tonight felt like I wanted to connect all this to probably the most pivotal verse in the whole Bible. So all this is happening, being spoken to Nicodemus. And then this great verse that you and I can quote by heart, and one of our favorite verses, I'm sure, as we talk about, for God so loved the world, that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. You know, this God kind of love. Because, Brother Eli, he didn't want us to see Jesus as a man. He wanted us to see that he's God. And the only way to make heaven our home, Brother Justin, is to accept the Son of God for who he is, as our Savior, because of God's love for our sister Stacy. So it's all connected to this guy who comes by night. Amen. He's smart. He's rich. He's a leader. He knows Jesus is a good man, a good teacher. But you gotta know that Jesus has to be lifted up above that. The combat. Mortality. Sin. All the things that are involved with the fall of man and sin. All the things because God gave us all to us. So there was a mineral show being held in Tucson. And there was a bin that had various gems inside of it. And there was one that was a blue violet stone, and it was about the size of a potato. And the vendor was there. He was selling his gems. And a man came up, and he picked up the stone, and he was looking at it. And he saw that the price of that stone was $15. So he said to the vendor, he said, $15. The vendor looked and he said, that's probably one of the ugly stones in that bin. I'll get rid of it. $10. The man said, I'll take it. I'll take it. I'll take that stone. It has since been certified as a 1,905-carat natural star sapphire. It is about 800 carats, and it is appraised at $2.28 million. To the average person, it looked like nothing. But to the one who recognized its value, he knew its worth. Can I tell you that is exactly what John 3:16 is about? Because God looked and seen the value of you and I, and he purchased it. Because he knows the greatness of our value, though other people may not see it or know it. God knows the value of us. Amen. John 3:16 is the magnifying glass for mankind. And it really summarizes the whole heart of the Bible. For God so loved the world. Amen. And from beginning, amen, Genesis, with every shadow and with every type, amen, till we come to the gospel, amen, where Jesus Christ, the Son of God, gives his life, amen, throughout the rest of the New Testament, where God shows his love for humanity. Amen. It is the magnifying glass. Amen. John 3:16 changes lives. Gaylord Gambarbe, General Secretary of the Bible Society in Zimbabwe, was passing out Bibles one day. He came to a very belligerent man who did not want to hear the gospel, and he gave him a Bible, Brother Craig. He said to him, he said, here's a Bible for you. The man said, I will take this Bible, Brother Dennis, I'm going to roll my cigarettes up, and I'm going to smoke it. That's what I'm going to do with this Bible. And the evangelist said to him, he said, listen, he said, just do me one favor. He said, before you smoke your cigarette in the pages of the Bible as you roll your cigarettes up, he said, would you promise me that you would read it? He said, I'll do that. He said, but this to me is nothing more than cigarette paper. 15 years later, Gaylord met that belligerent man at a Methodist conference, and he was now an evangelist. 15 years later, he gave a testimony. He said, I smoked Matthew, and I smoked Mark, and I smoked Luke, but when I came to John 3:16, amen, it changed my life. No longer could I be hard against God, but I had to give my heart and life to Jesus Christ because I recognized his love for me. Amen. John 3:16, it will change a life. Aren't you glad that it's more than just words on a paper? Amen. It is God's love story that is written to you and I.
Amen.
Hallelujah. What a great thought tonight.
And so, as we look at John 3:16, looking at everything that's happening with Nicodemus, the importance of having relationship and being born again, and the first step is believing in Jesus Christ and accepting the work of the cross. Amen. The Word of God says, "For God so loved." It is the most expressive action in the whole world. I don't know what is expressive to you. For your love language to be what you need to have expressed to you. Each of us is different. What expression means to us. But it is the greatest expression of God's love to each one of us as humanity and individually. That God so loved the world. The greatest expression. One man, Alfonso Lecuona, in 1750 wrote a book called The Glories of Mary. Very much Catholic in his background. And he wrote, "Mary so loved the world that she gave her son." Mary did good. God loved the world. Mary was God's choice to bear, to carry and to bear the Son of God. But God gave the greatest expression of love. For God so loved the world. There are 10 really key words in these 25 verses, or 25 words. If you were to look at them, and I wrote them down, what are the key words of John 3:16? First of all, it starts with God. He loved. Who did he love? The world. It's key to know that God loved. No one else did. God. What was the expression? It was love. God loves people. I said to you, I'm going to reiterate this just in case no one was here or said it. The movie The Shack. It's a very popular book. I know it's a phenomenal. I don't lose out if someone read it. I just want to tell you, I don't agree with all the philosophies. A lot of it can be Mother God. But one of the biggest things is thinking that love trumps God's justice. Love does not trump the justice of God. God's still holy. Even though love is powerful and strong, God loves, but if mankind doesn't make a commitment and a regeneration, a new birth in the blood of Jesus Christ, the love of God doesn't matter. He will die and go to hell. And so, you know, we live in a world of tolerance and being very cautious of what we say. Part of that I understand, but we've got to stop tiptoeing around tulips. Let me just say this. I wanted to say one other prayer request tonight, and I forgot. Because the Lord convicted me yesterday and today, we need to keep praying for President Trump. Yeah. You know, we do. He's making some very tough choices. You know, is he perfect? No. Do I agree with everything? No. But I think this. Can I just address this? Just because I think it helps us as believers, not going to go down a rabbit trip. But Melania is his wife, and maybe a week or two ago, she prayed and she read the Lord's Prayer. And so the media really scrutinized and criticized her. A couple of different things. Number one, I'm thankful for the transition I see of bringing God back to the White House. Right. Bottom line, that is something I appreciate. And because it is bringing God back to the place that we've not seen for a very long time, where we see our world leaders, but particularly our the United States of America, our leaders addressing God, honoring Him, and calling upon Him.
So I give that to President Trump. I mean, I believe he's a good man. I admire his business. There's no way around it. The man knows how to run a business.
Right.
And I mean, our government is a business. I'm going to stop there because I don't want to get so political. But when they criticized his wife, I just want to come back and say this. Number one, if I were to get up in front of a large volume of people, I would probably myself not even try to quote the Lord's Prayer. I wouldn't, because I get nervous, I get anxious, and you know what? I do it all the time in preaching. I have my notes right there. I need them, Brother Doug. I can really get it wrapped and twisted, you know. So I admire her for doing that, and admire her for organization that she led it. I find no fault in that. I see her as being honored to God, honored to people, honored to our country. And so let's pray for them. It's a tough place. So God so loved, amen, justice. Who did he love? He loved the world. Why? What did he do? Because of his love he gave. What did he give? His son. It's necessary that we believe on him, the Son, the work of the Father, so that we do not perish. We will perish. Amen. I'm not talking about an annihilation. I'm talking about you die and you go to hell. Perish doesn't mean that you're going to dissipate away. Amen. It means you'll die in an eternity in hell. So God loved us so much, he didn't want us to perish. But the alternative he gives us is everlasting life. I love life. Do you?
Yes.
I love life. You know, I enjoy a lot of aspects of life. You know, there are things I enjoy more than others, just the way that you do. But I love life. I engage in it, Brother Doug. I want to live a long time if I can. I enjoy it. I have even more reason, wonderful why. Two little girls that just like to keep me on my toes. Amen. I want to be around Sister Stacy that I can go in their house and dink their refrigerator. And I want to go out to Walmart, Brother Dennis, with them and be really loud at everyone. I'm just kidding. No, I want to be around. I enjoy it. It's a good gift. You know? But God's promise is everlasting. It's not like we're ever going to get cold. It's not like our hearts ever going to break again. Brother Doug, there's been times in my life, I'll be very transparent. There's been times in my life I felt hopeless over a situation. But I pray that's a terrible place to be. It's depressing and dark and lonely. And God gives me hope. But I'll never go through those times again, Brother Chris. Because God has promised everlasting. So those are the 10 key words. When we talk about love, like, I've met people before and counseled with people, and I'm not telling anything recent, I'm talking years ago, that truly believe like movie stars and other people really love them. Like, really love them. Like, they claim they got letters and phone calls and things from someone who, hello. Something's wrong with your thinking. It's a messed up type of love. Some folks have loved and never been loved back in return. But with God, it is a love that is not messed up. It's perfect. Perfect. And so when we look at his love, it's universal. He so loved the world. Amen. It is unknown in its force. Listen to what Paul wrote in Ephesians 3:19. And to know the love of God, which passeth knowledge, that ye might be filled with the fullness of God. Like, it's unbelievable how much you love. If I were to ask any of you here, I bring myself because I know me better than anyone else. Like, I love my wife like crazy. I love my girls like crazy. Like, I mean, some days it just feels like I love them more, Sister Keena. Like, they, but if I, it's just crazy to explain. But if you never experienced it, and you know, I talk with folks who's going to have their childhood, And they'll say, what is it like? I'll say, you know, the best way I can describe that for me as a father is like, immediately, you love that child. Like, I'm just meeting them, but I love them. Like, I give my life for them. Like, you love them so. My love is nothing compared to the love of God. The Word of God says that His love passeth knowledge away. Like, no one can even know about it. Well, the Word of God says,